So I wanted to start by asking you, Chris, obviously the show is called Home.
Yes.
Yeah. So what is your experience of home? How have we come to this point?
Okay, well, home for me has been essentially about this sense of belonging. And for me, it's been a kind of transient journey throughout my life. And I mean, originally it started from looking at Cyprus, a divided island, having lost a home, and that kind of started this whole inquiry about why and how does that make me feel about home. And also, increasingly, it became about memory of the old village, memory of people I'd lost, things around me. And since then, I've travelled around. I've gone to Asia, I've been back to Cyprus and back again. So this idea of home has never been static for me. It's always been this moving and experiencing. So home is not really about a house, a physical building, brick built, a roof. It's about this idea of belonging. And that belonging has always been in constant motion and swimming. So, yeah.
And was there somebody influential in your kind of early idea of home?
I think, if I can think back, I think my father and his death was very much a kind of seminal moment in the way that I thought about what home was and where I belonged. So I think that loss in itself was quite deeply felt. And so, and I actually remember when he died, my father was a carpenter. Shortly after, I sort of immersed myself in DIY.
Yeah, how old were you when you died?
I was 29.
Okay.
29, so he died 89 during the Berlin Wall and so on, coming down. So I remember those two dates embedded. And so I went into this trance of doing DIY. I went up to that point. I hadn't even touched the hammer or anything, so I became this expert. So I was kind of working through this idea of recreating his image in my head. And and also now recently with this, I did an MA 3 years ago. I started making this home within the studio space. I started using my father's drill, which it weighs about 10 kilograms. And, you know, to tap in screws this big. And, you know, you could use a remote one, for quite a much lighter version, but it somehow it was important for me to use this drill. And I became connected to his experience through that process. So I was kind of recreating him, that memory of him within my life. And it got embedded in my art making, which is a very important part of this investigation of what home is.
Mm. And we saw images of your father and in here,
yeah.
And this is your father,
yes,
as well.
Yes, yeah. Yeah.
Is this the way that you remember him? Is that a particular image that you return to?
I do, and it in some ways it's an idealised image. It's an image of him with his friends looking like Clark Kent somewhere, and this strong sort of tower of a man, you know. So I'd always look. I remember just idealising that image, and you know, when he left, I sort of it didn't ring right, and so.
And him being a carpenter, did that have any influence on you in terms of becoming an architect? Was that a separate story, or was that an influence as well?
I think that's a separate story, but certainly the latter part, where I developed this need to construct things, was very much born from that experience. But the architectural story is a much wider sort of. It was about trying to fulfil their needs and my needs at the same time. I always wanted to go to art school, but my parents wanted me to be a doctor and lawyer. So I thought architect would somehow be a middle ground, and then. The rest is a kind of history of trying to live both those lives together. And now it's several lives, the architect, the family man, the artist, and probably partly teaching too. So, yeah.
Yeah, I think it's interesting that you've already talked about kind of construction and memory and loss. and DIY, and when we look at a lot of your work, there are these cutouts, and there are spaces that are missing in them, that directly relate to something that's not there anymore.
Yeah. Yeah.
Can you talk a bit more about kind of loss within the images?
Yeah, I mean, in terms of loss is, in a way, it's that story of thinking of absent friends, about back to the village, that's something I put in a box. When the division came up, in my mind, I just put it in a box. I didn't feel anything at all. I remember thinking I'd lost about 300 marbles when the actual division happened. And then much later, when I went back, they opened up the border, that whole emotional roller coaster came flooding back. And I remember feeling quite upset for about a week because I'd actually seen the reality, and some of these images evoke some of that past. The one at the back in the middle, top middle, shows the village with the two roads, is reminiscent of that memory of going back. And I remember the church being so dominant and everything around it was like a miniature. And then this feeling of like going to a place, someone else is living in your home, you have to see it and then go back. It was quite surreal. So it had an impact on me, certainly.
And can you remember how you came to printmaking?
Yes, I do. I remember I got introduced by a friend about 20, 30 years ago, and they thought I would love printmaking because of the processes, and they were right. I was doing installation sculptures and painting at the time. And once I hit printmaking, I just found I was able to lose myself in the processes and the millions of accidents that you can get through process, and how you could guide those to feed a particular sensation that you want. And a lot of what I do is about trying to get that feeling through the process. And as you know, dry point is very much a process that I feel close to, largely because it enables me to actually tap into my subconscious. Essentially, that's where most of my images begin.
Because I know that you keep a dream diary.
I do, yeah.
And
a nightmare one.
And a nightmare one, yeah.
Which is the bigger one.
I think the nightmare one, certainly.
Yeah. When did you start keeping those?
I think I can't recall the time. It feels like all my life since I could start to write and draw. And drawing is also part of it. But it was almost a necessity to be able to record those subconscious feelings, which somehow were suppressed in my everyday life. So dreams for me became a true conduit, a true vehicle to what was going on in my life. They were unedited, you know. I didn't have to excuse them or make them fit into a system or try and justify them to my boss. They were raw material which I used as a starting point to begin the imagery. So I've always stayed close to the dreams because I feel they tell me more about me than my so-called reality.
And what did your family think about the diaries? Did they know about the diaries?
Well, some of my family know about my obsessions, but they think I'm mad. Others just, you know, think it's an oddity, an obsession. And most don't know, actually. You know, I was hoping they'll get to find out today. So it's this is a kind of me coming out in a way, in many ways.
So you have these, and I don't know if people here have seen Chris's diaries, but they're extraordinary pieces of creativity, I suppose. So you have those that are really raw and direct, and then how do the ideas come through from that? Where do you go? What's the process?
Well, it could start off with a a sort of doodle this big. Mm-hmm. I'll blow up the doodle and then start trying to get that. I don't try to imitate the graphic element of a dream. I'm interested in the feeling of mm-hmm. it. You know, was I anxious? Was I afraid? Was I being chased? Was I being looked at? Was I hiding? Those are the important elements, and then I convey them in a kind of codified way, like a motif where I just things that reappear, and it's like my own Morse code language, so that I've kind of shorthand really over the many years that I've been doing this, because I don't have much time, so I have to record something within about 10-20 seconds and then move on, and then look back at it and think, God, what must I have been thinking? But they are invariably the beginnings of the spark to the imagery that comes out. And it can happen also with poems. I do. Okay. I write lots of poems on the underground on the way to work and back, so they're also quite useful.
Well, how do those two things intersect? Do they?
They do. The kind of imagery, like the words and what's conveyed in the imagery, do tend to overlap. If you write for long hours over many lines, you find recurring words happen. So that's what happens. I have a whole library of recurring things that happen, like shadows and hidden and doors and a memory and the past. All these things that keep recurring, so they become part of the vocabulary, I guess, of what makes my creative process.
And when you came into printmaking, was dry point one of the first things you did, or did you?
No.
Like, did you try all sorts of things?
I did. Yeah.
Tell us about that.
Yeah, I started etching through Michelle's guidance, and it demanded quite a skill and being patient about the science of the process, but I enjoyed it immensely. And then I did lots of lino cut and. Had a few misfirings with registrations, but again, loved that because it created a kind of a book effect. I could create a graphic novel effect through lino cuts, which I've used quite a bit. Collagraphs, again, a form of painting with carborundum, and which you can merge with dry point and so many other techniques. And this is the wonderful thing with printmaking, you can mix different techniques and find ways to convey certain sensations through those techniques and allow those the science part to give you what you want.
Well, and as we all know, Chris loves a masking tape.
Yes, I do like a masking tape.
Yeah, Christmas masking
don't ask
tape.
Me how I use it, okay? It's,
well, I was just going to ask how you used it.
Well, there's an example, I think, there, actually.
Let's grab that.
If I can
grab a... Yeah.
Yeah, just brief.
Which way up? This way?
Yeah, I never know which way up. So essentially, it's a way of it's a graphic device to give you black etching mark, but I find it.
Put this back.
So there's a figure here. There's a tape, and this is actually an example I use with students to teach them how to do dry point and to give them a vocabulary, a different mark making through different techniques. So there's here you've got the masking tape. You've got, I think, sellotape here. You've got scratchings here with sandpaper. Here I've broken the actual thing and stuck it back together. You know, different ways of creating images and marks. And I find that quite exciting. And in a way, these turn out to be a lot better than the ones where I've tried too hard, where I've actually tried to make things happen. Where I've actually done test plates, the test plates themselves become, I find, a lot more vital, a lot more interesting.
So, there's always a challenge, I think, with printmaking about if you've drawn something already and then you're kind of copying it, you don't have the same life, do you?
Absolutely.
And you, you do just draw directly on these without any preparatory sketches, don't you?
Yeah.
Tell us why you like the line that you get from the dry point.
Well, the dry point, for those who are not sure, is essentially I'm drawing with a metal type of tool directly onto a plate. That plate could be metal. In this case, it's plastic because you can see through it.
Yeah.
And I'm making a mark. And if you And that's the tool that you use. If you,
Chris can demonstrate.
Get over, Chris.
That's nice dream.
Yeah. Oh god. Yeah. Well, it must have been quite. So essentially, it's this. I quite like to use a lot of pressure, because then what happens is, I'll explain. Yeah. Do not try this at home. That will do.
Okay.
Okay, so.
But when you feel it, it's really rough, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
Pass it around. In fact, if you want to have a go, let's have a little
scratch.
We can make a communal.
Yeah. Mind your fingers. Yeah. So essentially what happens when you scrape that tool across the surface, it creates a burr, like a ship that goes through the sea. You get that burr, which is this like wave-like effect. And when you actually apply ink onto the surface, the ink doesn't just deposit in the groove, it also deposits on the side. So what is essentially a very thin line becomes a very thick, smoky, sort of velvety line. Some of which you might be able to see. A lot of these lines on these prints behind you are single lines, but they look thick. And that's because of this burr. And because of that burr, you can only get about 4 or 5 really good images, because the press, once you run it under the press flattens out that burr. And so the line becomes thinner back again. And it's a quality that I like, because it creates this transformational quality to the image. It makes it look almost mysterious, dark, otherworldly. And in a way, that kind of lends itself to this idea of looking back at a sort of a dream or the past, which is always this smoky thing. It's there and suddenly it's not there. It's ephemeral. It's something that's disappearing as you look at it. And I quite like that effect.
Because you also work back into the place, don't you?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Some of the lines will be receding,
yeah.
And others he'll like scratch back into,
exactly,
to kind,
yeah,
of build them up.
Yeah.
Also, what's nice about the plastic is that you can obviously see through the plastic. So
yeah.
Do you ever layer up images in that way and look through?
I do sometimes. I mean, for instance, that particular one, the self-portrait, the middle one,
yeah.
I was actually sketching those 3 Victorian ladies at the National Gallery.
Uh-huh.
And whilst I was doing that,
yeah,
I saw my image in the actual plate itself.
Right.
Hence it's distorted,
right,
because
I reflected.
So I started drawing that, overlapping that,
yeah,
so to bring myself into the picture.
Yeah.
So, and then I added, obviously,
yeah,
masking tape, a very important feature.
Yeah.
And there's a door like this. The door is always a motif that I use. There's either someone peering behind it,
mm-hmm,
or hiding from it, so recurring themes, and you can see what.
So, what would be behind your ideal door?
Well, there's a question. I think more doors.
More door. That sounds like a nightmare again.
Yeah, I'm afraid so.
Yeah.
Yeah. More opportunities.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is that what you're hoping to find behind,
yeah,
the door then?
I guess I'm hoping that someone's not looking at me from behind the door.
Okay.
I hope it's a place where I can go through.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of the times, there's always someone looking.
There's someone watching.
There's someone watching, yeah.
And what's the sensation of being watched then, in terms of the work?
In terms of the work, a lot of the images formulate this sense of hiding from being watched. So you feel this sense of confinement, or the images develop this splicing where I cut off, where I want to cut off from that, and then I go somewhere else in a sort of seascape somewhere, lying down with my ideal lady. So it's kind of fantasized images, and then you've got the horror of the reality, sort of. There's always this duality going on, which I'm not always conscious, but it's always there.
They're often as well very urban, I find, the images. Is that, again, is that a conscious decision, or does it come out of dreams or somewhere else?
It comes out. I always, when I speak to students, they say to me, where do I get ideas from? And I always say, you always start from where you are now. So the urban thing is about where I'm now. If I'm on a train feeling claustrophobic on the central line, then that's what's going to happen in my images. Yeah, it's the way I feel at this present moment, not last week or the week before, but now.
Yeah.
And so I bring now into that image, and now could be that dream.
Yeah.
It's always about where I'm. And in a way, our lives get recreated, so I don't have to worry about it not being true, because it's really a culmination of everything that's come to that point to make me feel this way now. So now is really the important part. It's an accumulation of all the bits that have added to this point here.
Has there ever been anywhere on your travels where you felt not able to record that? Because as you travel, you make these images.
Yeah.
Have you been anywhere where you've just not?
Not really, because it's a lifeline to me. So if I don't do them, I'm dying. It's simple as that. I mean, don't tell my family, but here they are. It's like, you know, I'm dying. So I need to be doing that. Even when in China was the most difficult part, but I couldn't find a workshop or a print shop. But
Where were you in China?
In Shanghai.
Okay.
Shanghai. I started off in Hong Kong, went to Shanghai, and then much later, after 2 years, went to Singapore. About 6-7 month stints either side. But I take plastic plates with me wherever I go. So I'm drawing directly onto plates, and then when I get the opportunity, maybe 2 years later, I get to print them and see and try and remember. So in fact, a lot of the ones upstairs are actually from Asia, plates that I've kept for a while, and then when I've got back to the UK, managed to print again. So,
and are there places that you would, both physically and metaphorically, want to return to make these images again?
I mean, I'd like to go back to the village. I mean, the soothest memory I have of happiness, which is a term I don't use ever, is me running in the fields chasing butterflies on my own in Cyprus. That image is to me, it sounds ideal, maybe sentimentalized, but I can remember, it's raw to me. And I don't know if any of you know, but I stayed there for 3 years as a child with my brother, away from our parents. And so to us, a sense of home became nature, extended family. So we were embedded in nature, and that love of nature hasn't really gone from me. I still hark back to those moments, however long they were, when I was 8 to 11, you know, of being one with nature. I mean, we were like wild cats, just literally living off the land, sleeping wherever we would, anyone's house, because everyone was family. People would just tell you they're sleeping over there tonight, and then going to school hand in hand, like that image on the bottom, top, middle, with my brother.
Have you taken any of this work back to Cyprus?
No, I was hoping this exhibition would be a kind of, at the beginning of that process of introducing it to some of my family who are here, Dimitri, and obviously my wife knows about it, but, you know, to get them to see my other side, which they haven't, and then taking it back there and see what they think. But, you know, you'll see the work, and not everything is idealized past. Some of it is things that have been locked away for reasons, which have come out too.
What's been the most difficult part about revealing this part of yourself?
I think it's coming to terms with some of the demons, the things that have been put away in the boxes, certain family dysfunctions that have been lying dormant for many years, and that's been difficult to sort of, but also cathartic too, necessary, almost like trying to bring it out, there's no point, and try to reveal what is essentially hidden. So that's been quite challenging. Other than that, the rest is been quite emotionally necessary. almost. And this showed for me it's quite an intimate journey, and I hope people get a sense of that when they look at the work, that it's really me. This is my diary, my guts spilled out on the wall.
Can you tell us a little bit about each kind of little series that we've got here in the room? Do you want to start with this kind of?
I mean, Sarah helped me try to edit down 3,000 prints down to what you see on the wall. So she's got a lot to be, I've got a lot to be thankful for helping me in doing that. So there are very loose sections here. This is a portrait, self-portrait section. So top left is an image of a symbol of me and mother. That was done in Singapore. And then it evokes a sense of the old time village. The one in the middle here is in the 1980s, how my flat used to be with the old stereo. And shortly after, I had a break-in and that thing got stolen. But you can see the bottom image there of me living within 1 meter radius. That was my life. The computer, lamps, all crushed into this sort of, and that's me up the top as well. And, you know, 80s, where are we now? 30 years on, not much has changed. I still look fairly disheveled. This is a scene of me in hospital 6 months ago, having had facial cellulitis. Not much with spots and things, but I won't go into that. And obviously using masking tape. Don't forget that, okay? Okay. And
it's your trademark.
This one, bottom right, has got dry point, but also acrylic and carborundum, where I'm using painterly gestures to suggest marks. If you look at that stripe in the middle, that's like a paintbrush swiped across, and then there are like poppy-like things, and I think it's called Smell the Roses.
Okay, so we've got kind of portraits there. Yeah. What about this section over there?
This section here is, it's the top left is really a dream sequence. It's a series of dreams all merging into one. The one at the bottom is an etching which has got various techniques. It's got something called sugar lift, and I can explain this to people later. There's etching and I think dry point combination. The one to the far right bottom is a dry point of a painting by Motherwell, an abstract painting, but it looks like figures, and I've kind of used that. And the two in the middle are very recent ones of my kind of just how I've been feeling. This exhibition has, in a way, made me look back at my life and looking back at various things. So they're about looking back and also forward. I mean, the bottom middle you can see is a train scene, but it's spliced in with collaged images of the past and ideas of home. So it's this sort of overlaying process that of me looking back. So really, I'm still doing the same things I did 30 years ago. I'm still exploring this idea of home. I'm still trying to find this idea of belonging, and I'll always be looking for it.
And when people go upstairs, you'll see some images that are kind of frames, and the reversal out from a frame. And I think it's really interesting to think about framing, not the literal frame, but how you approach the images because of that layered way that you are framing an image for us.
Yeah.
Can you talk a bit about framing?
Well, it's a frame, but it's also a cut and paste. You're cutting some image from somewhere and you're putting it somewhere else, and it's this sense of displacement, and sometimes these things overlap, and the layers, the time lapses overlap. They could be of the same scene but in a different time. So in a lot of the Shinkole dry points, when people go up, they're basically images of dreams, and they're spliced in with old black and white photograph cutouts of family members who've all deceased, mostly some of my family, some have less desirable elements of the family, all cut and pasted. So you yourself won't know, but I know that some of these people are not very nice. So they're all somehow merged into this sort of swimming in this modern narrative that I create. And in a way, I've shown them as a group because I wanted everyone to see the process, how they evolve from the starting point and then they succeed and develop. I don't normally show things in groups, but I think in this instance it's useful to see how the workings of my mind sort of develop the images.
Mm, definitely.
Yeah.
And obviously you mentioned a little bit earlier about, you know, time.
Yes.
But you're amazingly prolific and you make work like wherever you are all the time. There's no kind of excuse about not making stuff.
Mm.
Like, how do you fit together all these different roles that you have? You've got, you know, you're obviously an architect, you're a father, husband, artist, you know, and all the other things. How does it fit together for you?
The immediate answer to that, very badly. It's not something... people talk about this idea of balance. I mean, you know, I've never seen that. I've never had... It's an ebb and flow, or a struggle between trying to do things you need in a to practically survive, to do things with keeping your soul and your passion alive and your duty. So there's this constant tug of war, but it's one that generates the narrative of the work. Without it, the work is not, it's vacant. In a way, the work requires that sort of, I know there's a cliche with the struggling artist, but it's very much part of the work. I have to bring that as part of the dialogue. I can't ignore it. It's happening. So if I've got half an hour to do something, then that half hour slot will be used very efficiently. So I'm going to do something explosive to try and generate. So in a way, I'm kind of like a creative thief. I'm sort of, you know, windows of opportunities, stolen moments, and you know. And then I also have to somehow edit and keep separate friends to edit these different lives sometimes, and sometimes they overlap and sometimes they don't.
And when you're making the images, I mean, is that image, you said it's about like now, you know, if there's half an hour to do something, it's now, or if you're travelling, it's about now. Is it really about now, or is it about somewhere else, in some other place?
Well, now I'm always looking back, so it's about the past, but it always gets spliced in with the now. So I try to bring the two worlds together, the now and then, what's happened. That sort of friction, that sort of way in which the two splice in and how they interact is really what I'm interested in, the then and now. And that's the important part.
Are you conscious of doing that, or is it just an automatic?
It's an automatic. I really don't, a lot of the time I don't. I find it just happens, and then I look back and I think, I think you've done this before, this way, or that particular motif or that style. It kind of, and in a way the printmaking process also leads you there. What you can achieve through certain methods almost directs you. You know, oh yeah, I can achieve this. I'd like to do that in lino because I want to show this graphic kind of element. Or, you know, sometimes the technique will take you there.
And in terms of other printmakers or other artists, have there been any particular inspirations?
There's been quite a few. I mean, I quite like the work of Mona Hatoum, who's an Algerian sort of immigrant. I mean, she's Palestinian born, lives out here and does installations on sort of political conflict and displacement. So I like her work. The work of Christian Bortanski, again dealing with themes of displacement, this idea of the missing house and so forth. Rachel White Reads, the house in East London, that was quite a seminal piece that quite inspired me. She don't know, she casts the spaces of things, so thereby glorifying the memory of that thing by just casting the space within. So, and she did that with a house. I'm sure there's a Janice at Christo who wraps buildings, who brings in an architectural massive dimension and completely transforms buildings into these monuments. I'm sure there's one. Van Gogh, Van Gogh is my all-time inspiration. Mm-hmm. He'll always be there. And Munch, Edward Munch, with his...
And I don't know if everybody is familiar with kind of Mona Hatoum and some of the other artists that Chris mentioned, but alongside the idea of absence and presence, there's also, in a lot of that work, a lot of violence.
Mm.
Particularly, actually, violence against, like, the body, the personal, and the body standing in for a political stance, or it may just be about the personal in that.
Mm.
And I think in your work as well, the kind of process you're making is, I mean, there is a sort of strength to it, but it is also, it's a physical process.
Yeah.
And the motion can be quite violent within it. What do you think about me saying that about the work?
I think you're right.
Yeah.
I get a lot out of it when I'm pulling at this surface. I feel a sense of relief. There's a sense of a sort of aggression. In a way, that violence almost makes the image in some ways. But I try not to be too prescriptive with it. I try to allude to it rather than be... in previous works, installations, I've been much more brutal.
Mm.
But with the printmaking, I'd like to think it's a bit more... not vague, but less in your face. It's there, but you have to come to it in a roundabout way. I hope that it's not as brutal as some of my installation work, which some of you've
seen. So tell us about the installation work for those.
Well, just very briefly, I did a MA 3 years ago, and it was on the same themes of home and how that's informed by memory. And so it was a practice-based masters whereby I was creating works, researching other artists doing similar works, evaluating them, and going cyclic way, and that became the MA. And I did, my final show was a series of installations, which I'll show you another time, but one was of a cot, which was cut in half with this metal sheet stuck right through the middle.
Mm-hmm.
So it was kind of like a metaphor for things that how I felt, and this idea of home. The first home anyone has is a cot, your baby. So it was this brutal kind of clear message. And the other one was a wall, constructed an old wall with anaglypta style wallpaper, which was dissected by a chair right through the middle. So you only saw two halves of the chairs. You couldn't actually sit on it. But if you imagine yourself sitting on the chair, it wouldn't be very nice. So it was this sense of division again.
Mm-hmm.
You can take it back to the Green Lion division, you can take it back to all sorts. So those were the final pieces, and they were, I was quite proud of them. I don't often say that, but yeah.
And if I was to say to you, well, you've called this exhibition home, but could you have called it family? What would you say?
I wouldn't agree. I would say looking for home would be a more appropriate title, because it's this constant excavating, this constant need to keep looking for somewhere to settle, to belong, because it's never a static thing for me. So I would say looking for home would be more appropriate. And family are in there too. Let's not, And my boy Alex, who will be here later, he's mentioned in some of the works, So he absolutely loves trains. So some of them are, the train images are sort of attributed to him.
Has anybody got any questions for Chris? Please.
Why don't you use colour, since you want to express so much?
That's a good question. I think practically it takes more time, which I don't always have. When I do the odd painting, I always go straight to colour. It's never black and white. I think it's just more... Also, the themes that I'm always depicting are normally dark, and they're about this misty darkness that fades away. But I'm not against the idea, and it's
no,
a very good question.
It was a restraining thing you put upon yourself.
No, it's just a case of I'm focusing in a way the dark places are where I am, and I love colour, and every now and then it does come out, but not necessarily in printmaking. Mm-hmm. But maybe there's time for that too. Yeah, thanks, Sophie. Yeah.
I was interested when you talked about the different layers that are picked up on the shapes and the construction of
yeah.
the images. And I'm not sure how much you want to link the two, but to me there seems a very architectural element to a lot of your drawing and a very strong awareness of spaces and people within spaces. And
yeah. Yeah, I think subconsciously I can't avoid that aesthetic. It comes in, the sense of perspective. Sometimes it's a device to draw attention to the image, to create a composition which focuses things. And other times it's like a satire on the advertisement of idealized architectural homes, you know, where we see them on estate agents' billboards and things like that. So I'm kind of bringing it in as a kind of Mickey take, I guess, to that process. So it's dual. And I do have that architectural sort of three-dimensional perspective going. I can't avoid that, I guess. Yeah, but it's a device more than anything else to draw attention to particular elements. Yeah.
You draw almost constantly in exhibitions, don't you?
Yeah, I do.
Of anybody I know, you probably go to more exhibitions than.
Well, yeah. Don't tell my wife if she's here.
But you're supposed to be working.
Yeah, I sometimes kind of I sort of smuggle away on my route back home with shopping, you know, sort of as a sort of gift, you know, to sort of. But I do, and because of that, I have so little. Every moment it becomes vital. So, sketching the masters and recreating them is an important part of a ritual of. Thinking about my own way, how would I interpret what this artist has done? How would I do that? Looking at their method and, you know, inspired. I mean, Van Gogh, for instance, and the Munch exhibition at the museum was amazing. Their inspiration, I can't help. And I can't help but actually gain energy from those artists. Mm. Yeah.
Any other thoughts or?
Michaela? Hello.
Hello.
Nice to have you. Alex, any questions for you?
I took my home here.
Oh, you took your home.
You asked me. I'm Chris' colleague.
Yeah.
Yes. We were sitting next to each other.
Yes.
So little by little, I got into his world.
Yeah.
And his lovely drawings.
She's been very helpful in putting images where I'm really bad with IT.
Yeah.
She's the expert. You know,
help
me with the images that you've received. And
and we were discussing about the exhibition, about home, what is home.
Hmm.
And he told me, so tell me what is home for you. And for me, home is here.
Yeah. It's who you love.
Mom, my husband.
Hello. Hello, Mama. Hi, Alex. Nice to have you here. Yeah.
So,
In a way, I hope, if anything, you come away with your own feelings for what home could be to you.
Του κόσμου μ' αρμενίζει.